All right, everybody. Welcome to Reactive-Oriented Architecture with Grails and Groovy. Thanks for coming. My name is Steve, and I work for a Boston-based startup called Third Channel. And I've been drinking coffee literally all day. So let's talk about architecture. We've got a bit of a journey ahead of us. It's a very long presentation. It's an hour and a half. There's a lot of stuff we're going to be covering. It's the end of a very long day. I think there's beers afterwards. So I'm going to stop periodically for questions. But yeah, please feel free to hold the questions until I stop. So the agenda for today, and it's not too late to go see Ken Cousins talk, I'm going to cover monolithic apps will ruin you, service-oriented architecture and microservices, a reactive application and what makes an application reactive, practical development and caveats when doing this in Grails and Groovy, and some case studies, including how we're using it at Third Channel. So as I get started, I want to ask you all a couple questions and keep them in the back of your mind as I go on. Have you ever had to go through a major refactoring of your application? I take it that's a yes. How did that go? Have you ever had to go on an archaeological expedition or a giant whale hunt in your code base anytime you need to add a new feature? Have you had to drag in some poor developer who's been at your company for years because he's the only one or she's the only one that understands how anything works? Have you ever looked at your database schema and thought, why are there so many tables in our database? And have you ever been distraught at the number of joins you need to run in order to fetch a batch of records? Have you ever dreaded executing the test suite? Now, has anyone here worked on a major project where the unit tests alone took longer than 15 minutes to run? Yeah, yeah. How about 30? Yeah. Did you ever notice that developers, when they're working on those projects, tend to not run the tests because they take so long? And how was the build stability? On the flip side, has anyone worked on a major project where there were no tests? Yeah, I'm sure we all have. So if you laughed, and I assume, these are all symptoms of what I call, what is called a monolithic application. And if you laughed, I'm assuming that means you've worked on something like this. Now, a monolith is a single logical executable or unit, often comprised of three separate components, particularly within a web application. You have your view layer, which is your CSS, your HTML, your JavaScript, the middle tier, which contains all of the business logic, and your data storage. For example, this is a little diagram that I'm going to use periodically throughout, and it's supposed to represent a e-commerce application. So the cloud is the internet. The black box represents our particular application. The blue icons represent individual components or contexts within the application. So the shopping cart is, your shopping cart storing, users' items as they're going around and clicking them. The money bag represents the order billing software, the order management system, or the billing component. The little book is the administration page, sorting the products, making collections, that sort of thing. And then the screen is just a general web view, the web interface. So a monolith, it's interesting. So a monolith application feels natural, right? It contains all the features and logic necessary for handling a single request within a single process of your application. Your developers can generally run and test the entire app all at once on their laptops. Perhaps the most attractive feature of the monolith is that if a development team, even a small one, can reach the minimum viable product for your application very quickly. Everything's right in line. Again, all the logic's right there. You can get it done pretty fast. There's only a single artifact to deploy, which makes deployment and DevOps incredibly easy at first. Monolithic apps scale horizontally by deploying whole new instances of the monolith, probably behind a load balancer, with perhaps maybe some slave databases and a master replication database, and it can get exponentially more complicated. Now, I consider this very wasteful, as we scale the entire application rather than just the individual components that require it. For example, if we're receiving a flood of requests for our order management system or the shopping cart, wouldn't it be nice if we didn't have to scale the entire thing out just to handle those additional orders? However, I generally regard these single logical units as an evil piece of software. Like I said, it feels like the right thing to do, and you start out quickly, especially at the beginning. You start out strong, right? You're adding controllers here, domain objects there, You know, one plugin for security, super easy. But you can be blinded by the early gains as you're moving towards your first release and you aren't thinking towards the future. As these domains grow, you start adding relations all over the place. And can you look at a schema or a class diagram like this and be like, yeah, this is awesome. Now, I'm sure we've all worked at places, right, that have, this by the way, is the largest one I could find online. I'm sure we've all worked at places that have, like, on the wall of your development area, like, just pieces of paper just duct tape next to each other, right? We've all seen those. Anytime you see that have to happen, that's bad. It's really bad. The complexity of your application will soon become enormous, especially as you grow. At the beginning of the project, everything seems fine. You know, things aren't too bad. But once you start getting larger, you start attracting more users, you start hiring more developers, it gets much more difficult. Scaling development is very difficult. The ability to add new features, fix bugs, or resolve technical debt cannot scale with the size of a monolith application. Throwing more developers at it will not help. They'll just get in each other's way. There comes a point where every new developer you hire will have diminishing returns on the rest of the application. Before I joined Third Channel, I worked as a consultant for a number of years, and we go around to these different large companies. And I worked at one particular one where they reached a point where they were basically rebuilding version 2 of the application as another monolith, and they had a whole team of developers. They were still hiring, but they needed to bring in consultants, and the team there was not happy. I'm sure if anyone's here worked as a consultant, sometimes coming in, the people who were there give you a lot of hostility. In their development room or area, they had one of those white paint walls, or whiteboard walls. And I came in one morning, and one of the best passive aggressive statements I've ever seen, someone had scrawled on the wall in the middle of the night, "You can't make a baby in 1 month with 9 women." I messed that up last time I did that, where I said you can't make a baby in 9 months with 1 woman, and people gave me a lot of looks. And trying to refactor anything within the application, forget it. I've seen it happen many times. Your company will start out by creating a team to re-implement a particular feature or rebuild an application, and that sounds great. Except eventually this team is going to start taking too long. Soon enough, the managers are going to start screaming for new features, new updates in the existing application, and then your second team is going to have to maintain feature parity with the old system, and it's just going to keep going. And as the size of your code base increases, the computational complexity will exponentially increase and will have adverse effects on maintenance. There's been papers that have studied this. Now, there's no real empirical value they can give to it. It's been noted based on things like broken builds and things like that. It can also just be downright miserable. Has anyone here ever have to work on a new project and you open up the application in IntelliJ, because that's the best editor, and looked at the maze of controllers or domains, just seem to explode out at you, and just give a sigh. Toiling away on a project which is always growing and is always broken, never seems to get fixed. You work on a small little piece all day long and nothing ever seems to get better. This can have an adverse effect on developer morale and motivation. And this is such a misguided architecture, it makes you wonder exactly how we collectively ended up here. And I blame it largely at the feet of the large popular web frameworks. And I realize the irony of saying that while I'm at a conference about frameworks. But they're touted as if they're a magic cure for building your app or your product, that your company should just be based entirely around a framework. Like, have you ever met somebody and you ask them what they're using at their company, and they're like, oh, we're a Ruby on Rails shop, obviously. I argue that framework choice is largely irrelevant unless it's Grails or Spring. When people ask you, what technology are you using? The answer should be something like, that's difficult. We've got a Java app that runs our search. We've got a Grails-based app that uses our user logon. We've got a Rails front end, that sort of thing. So again, and I think one of the main points of this talk is that architecture choice is more important than any framework. I'll say that again, but we all know that only JVM languages should even be considered. So I'm going to stop there. Any questions so far? The points I've covered, basically, I really hate monolithic apps. And monolithic development will not scale. Questions? No. Good. Next session, shattering the monolith. So if we take our anecdotal design and e-commerce store from before, there's different architectures styles out there that help to try and alleviate the monolithic approach. And one of the most famous in the past decade or so has been service-oriented architecture. With SOA, one would break up each feature into an individual component or service. And so you can see here, I've broken up the monolith into every component or context has its own service now. These calls are traditionally synchronous over HTTP or some other mechanism, you know, WSL, maybe SOAP. So it's imperative that each one return as quickly as possible. Now, this architecture keeps the individual features easier to manage and keep track of, which reduces overall complexity dramatically, as we can examine each service in isolation rather than one large code base. And it's easier for people to keep the application in their head. Now, before I go into why that's really cool and important, SOA specifically has its own issues. First, having this web of interconnected services can quickly go out of control. Having to configure service nodes so that they know where all the other ones are can be cumbersome to manage. And there have been attempts, again, to mitigate that. Has anyone ever used an enterprise service bus before? Yeah. So an ESB, as it's called, is oftentimes another layer of complexity that you add onto the system by, and what an ESB does is it's designed to sort of intelligently route your traffic as it goes along, which, you know, sounds helpful, except again, it's another complicated layer in this puzzle. Furthermore, a lot of times when people implement SOA, what they're really doing is just connecting monoliths together, which is also really bad. And so given these pain points, I think that this leads right into talking about microservices, which is a buzzword I'm certainly sure you couldn't have escaped having come here when literally half the talks are about them. So what exactly is a microservice architecture? I believe microservices are born out of a desire to be more specific when we talk about service-oriented architecture. If you look at what people are writing about the approach, you can see that it is clearly an attempt to be more focused about using services, and certainly how we manage the teams working on them. A microservice should be concerned with only one context. This helps to avoid having each service become a monolith on its own. So back to this example, here we've split up each of the specific components into their own bounded context. And I say bounded context, I've been saying that for a bit, but I say that because it's an important metric. Because you may hear folks say something absurd like a microservice needs to be under 1,000-ish lines of code in order to qualify as micro, which I disagree with. A microservice should surround a particular, again, context within your application, meaning that it's responsible for a particular section of contiguous business logic. Excuse me. In other words, it's the authoritative source on one thing within your application. A microservice architecture emphasizes the communication between services be dumb, as opposed to ESBs, which can contain complex routing and even more business logic. So rather, all the business logic should be contained within the service, and they should use very simplistic communication strategies between each other. So back to this example, each service could communicate with each other via dumb or single-minded methods. So, you know, again, HTTP is a candidate, but instead of using, you know, ESBs or anything like that, we could do something like, has anyone heard of HDOS? I can never pronounce it, but Hypermedia is the application of engine state, which is, you know, one strategy, or my preferred way, use message brokers. This helps facilitate asynchronous communication between your message broker, and it utilizes a technique called a message queue. So they generally follow this pattern, where messages are routed through an exchange, which are then placed on a queue, and then messages are then plucked off the queue by an attached waiting consumer. Being this a pivotal conference, I should mention that RabbitMQ is probably one of the best message brokers you're going to find out there. It was born out of, financial industries, as they needed something for their high-frequency trading. So RabbitMQ came out. For the Grails world, we have an excellent plugin written by Peter Ledbrook and Jeff Brown, which works really, really well. And what Rabbit in particular, or message brokers in general, allow us to do is, again, taking the example, I could break off the order management and the shopping cart system, put them behind a couple queues. And the quickest win in doing just this is that now our application can place items in a user's cart and take orders asynchronously. And in effect, when the user does that, it happens immediately. So imagine the flurry of users ordering from you, and you're unable to take the money fast enough. And with this scenario, the order is placed on the queue, and your users go back to browsing or purchasing even more. This frees up the request threads in the front end for other users, so you're not blocking on the billing component, which may require expensive credit card call operations. Second. Within a microservices approach, we should make sure that we are only using RESTful communications. Now, this does not mean HTTP. This basically just means that we never, ever share state. Trying to keep track of state across a distributed service will lead to madness. So while we're talking about a simple communication strategy, make sure that REST is a part of it. Another part of the microservices is make sure that you're using dedicated cross-purpose teams. So teams in charge of a service should come from a variety of disciplines: engineering, QA, art and design, project management, perhaps even a deployment engineer, et cetera. And yes, I mix Star Wars and Star Trek references. Please don't get mad. So before I eventually get into some of the caveats of this approach, let me tempt you with why this is really cool. So again, it's easier to reason about these small code bases. Each engineer should be able to understand and hold the majority of the service within their mind as they're working on it. Thus, when a defect occurs, it's easier to know where within the service the problem within the code lies. When a new feature needs to be added, it's easier to know exactly where to build and how to add it in so that it will, and how it will affect the other components. Maintenance and adding new features becomes vastly easier. You'll find that iterating on a particular service is much quicker, and it's easier to context shift when it's time to work on another service. Now, this results in rapid long-term development. By focusing our developers into teams responsible for each service, this keeps them more focused and out of each other's way. Which again is a very common problem with monolithic apps. So it's also easier to scale and deploy and destroy, which is a very interesting concept. Because again, back to this example, we've broken out these features into individual applications and spun up one node per each context, connected the user's cart to a queue and order processing to another queue. Now, if we suddenly get a huge demand on orders and a shopping cart, we can programmatically spin up new instances to handle that load without losing any orders. Does anyone remember Andy Glover's talk from yesterday? He had a thread on how rapidly iterating is the key to beating out your competitors. And I think right here is exactly what he was talking about, because it's much easier to refactor these applications, both in terms of adding new features or removing old ones. If we need to change a particular service, say the inventory check when adding a product into a cart, we can do so without impacting the rest of the application. Further, if we decide to totally revamp, say, the billing service, and say we want to make it out of Rat Pack, we can develop the new service quickly. As we're starting something brand new, the rush of the monolith, we can start building it really quickly. And we can slap it on that queue without directly impacting or interrupting the others. And in fact, this can lead to some nice A-B testing, because we could compare our refactored billing service by having both the old and the new billing services listen and compete with each other on the same queue, see which one's faster and time it, a bunch of things like that. Additionally, this allows us to use the right tool for each individual job. So not every service needs to use the same languages or the same frameworks. Within an SOA or microservice approach, each service can be constructed with the technologies that best suit its context and its functionality. If the main product, browse web interface, is best suited for a standard web framework like Grails, you know, that's perfect. What about the shopping cart? Maybe we build it with a Redis database. No sweat. What about the order placement? We could try some Spring Boot, since that's, you know, all the rage these days, with some Spring integration and a Postgres database. Why not? Plus, I firmly believe that this helps to improve the morale of your developers. When it's time for a new service, people will get really excited to try something new that they've learned. And it's great feeling to work on something new, right? Imagine if, you know, your manager comes in and says, "Hey, let's do this new service. I want you in charge to design it." You know, that's awesome, and there's a lot of contentment within that, and a lot of job satisfaction. Furthermore, having each service distributed into its own, or each having each service separated out, gives it you know, their own code repository, which helps preserve history. And so that's a nice little added bonus to be able to keep the history about each service so you know the history of that particular application. Has anyone heard of Conway's Law before? No? Yeah, so it's sort of a tongue-in-cheek quote from this programmer named Melvin Conway in the 1960s. And his law basically states that the structure of a computer system reflects the social structure of the company that made it. While something of a joke, it does have a bit of truth to it. So is your, who here has a company that's organized in such a way that you have your QA team and your UX and design team and your engineering team, yeah, right? With microservices, the idea is to break those teams up and, like I was saying earlier, make a bunch of cross-discipline teams that are in charge of each service. Right? So if I'm working on the internal, a bunch of internal tools, I might have a dedicated engineer, dedicated DBA, dedicated QA people, dedicated UX design person. This is really satisfying way to work because you have a bunch of people with a bunch of different inputs, and they're all working together. They're all talking and communicating very effectively. One of the best experiences I ever had as a developer is I had the QA person for my project literally sitting right next to me, and she was awesome. Anytime I pushed a code, she would push some code, she would get it. If it broke, she'd lean over and be like, hey, fix it. And before you even made it in Jira, it was great. And perhaps the biggest advantage of all of this is that in the end, it should, if you do it right, save you money. Headaches, lots of headaches, and money. And I know if any of you perked up at this are very skeptical, I don't blame you. I mentioned this to a coworker, and he said, all I see is that you want to pay Amazon a bunch more money for all these additional services. And, you know, while initially that might be true, I borrowed this slide from a Martin Fowler's website, but as demand on the application grows, I can scale just the components that I need that are needed rather than needing to replicate the entire monolith as demand grows. In the beginning, this may not seem like much. Right? However, consider that as your application becomes larger and more complex, more resources are going to be needed to power the entire thing, which results in more machines and resources that may just be there to patch over all the small bounded contexts of your application, which are truly demanding the attention. So if I have, let's say, 6 times normal demand per usual on the billing system only, and I argue that it should be cheaper to add 6 small services just to handle that traffic rather than build out the monolith 6 times. It also leads to more efficient developers. Again, if you're able to conceptualize easier on your code base, and you're able to add new features faster, and you're able to get work done faster, I guess smaller code bases are faster code bases. And developers are more expensive than machines, and spending less money on more developers, or spending less money on developers and machines is the best case. And then, of course, we can use that extra money to buy developers beer, because developers love beer. So, you know, this all sounds great, right? There's certainly some downsides to this microservice approach, which I'll get into later. But generally, though, I hope that you agree that, you know, this does have an appeal, right? But I can go back if you want a photo. Do it. All right. But we can do better. We can squeeze out even more power from our resources. So I'm going to stop right there for a minute. If anyone has any particular questions, I'm going to take a sip of coffee. All right. Now, before I proceed, I want to talk about the cap theorem. Has anyone heard of the cap theorem? Yeah, all right. So, for those who don't know, basically what it says is that the C stands for data consistency. The A stands for availability, high availability, meaning that your application should be available whenever a user requests something of it. And it should have good partition tolerance, meaning that it should be able to withstand errors in one system should not affect another system. And the cap theorem basically says that of those 3 components within a distributed application, you're going to have to pick 2 of them because you can't have all 3. And this theorem comes from a paper which proves something called Brewer's conjecture. In 2012, this paper contained a formal proof of this conjecture, and it graduated to a full-on theorem. And basically what the paper said is that while Brewer's correct in that you're only allowed two of these features, it's not fixed. So these cap choices can be made at a service level. Furthermore, it also suggests, meaning that, you know, some services may not be as available than other services, but they might be more data consistent. But it also suggested that web applications are best suited for having high availability and high partition tolerance. But anything involving money, you're going to want high consistency. So these distributed applications might not be the best fit for a system that's dealing with users' money. And again, it's a sliding scale. So I may not be able to keep data consistency across my entire distributed platform, but I could keep my individual services fairly consistent with each other. Interestingly, this paper is also the origin of the term eventual consistency. Has everyone heard of eventual consistency? Yeah. So basically what that means is that in a highly consistent system, after a single update, every component has access to that change, right then. In an eventually consistent system, after an update, eventually all the components will see a change. So if I make a change in one of my systems, eventually that data will get propagated out as needed. But again, I just want to reiterate real quickly that architecture choice is more important than any framework. And if we accept that microservices are good, how should we build each service? Like I was saying earlier, how do we squeeze even more power out of each system? And so now the focus of the talk, I suppose, I argue that reactive microservices are the ideal web architecture. Basically, what this means is that we follow a distributed microservice architecture, but each service follows the reactive approach. And now when I say reactive, I've been stalling on that for a while now, so let's get exactly into what I mean by that. So reactive is a bit of a buzzword that came from a company called TypeSafe, which are the maintainers of the Play and Akka frameworks. Has anyone used or heard of Boo? Yeah. But while I don't use Play or Akka very much, they do have some interesting thoughts on how to build web apps. So basically a reactive application should have four reactive principles. The first one is that it should be event-driven, meaning that we use asynchronous message passing, or our application should be built around the concept of asynchronous message passing. Take advantage of the asynchronous features within your language or framework. And communication within the system should be done via asynchronous immutable events rather than long procedural code. This naturally promotes highly decoupled code. Sender and recipient can be constructed without having to know or care about implementation details of the others. And I think this is a very important point, and it's probably the most important point of reactive programming, is that all of the other points come naturally from adopting this step. But in other words, what this means is never block. If you have a long-running code, never, ever, ever block the thread. So as an example, suppose we had an e-commerce app which included a service that created and processed orders. So in this version, we use several additional service collaborators to do things like when an order comes in, we verify that we have inventory, and then if we do have enough inventory for the product, that we charge the user and then send out emails if it's successful. But if the inventory is not available, let's send out an apology that, oh, sorry, we actually didn't have the product that we thought we did. Now, imagine that each of these takes a very long time to do, right? Calling, if I'm billing the user, I have to make sure that the credit card company is processed, and trying to communicate with third parties synchronously is a no-no, so don't do that. Maybe the inventory process takes a while, but just imagine that each of those is a long time. Now that is gonna block that particular thread so that other users can't come in and you can't process more orders. Now, imagine this code versus something like this. Here I'm actually using something called, or a library called Reactor. I built a little library on top of it to sort of simplify it for this particular use case. But imagine this code instead. Now what I'm doing is I'm taking that same order, I'm validating that it's correct via the simplistic method, and then I'm just broadcasting a notification through an event service. So here's the same method. Now where did the rest of that code go? So in the on order colon created, I'm just sort of making my own namespace for these event keys, we execute the first services job. Then we check the inventory, then we have another listener which is listening for the inventory and then sending out a new event that is dependent on the result of marking the inventory for holding. And then in the money service, I basically check that if if I receive an order inventory true event comes through, then I bill the user. And then on in the email service, based on true or false from the, from this event, I send out either a confirmation email or a consolation email. Now this all happens asynchronously. But some of you might be saying, but Steve, that code is spread across three different slides rather than one concise little block. Why is this better? And so I argue, one, this is happening asynchronously, right? So it's not blocking the user. And two, this is much, much easier to unit test. It's also much more decoupled, right? Imagine having to go back here and all of your unit tests, you know, mock out each of these collaborators. Ugh. Versus testing this, where I simply fire an event at it. Nice. Anyway, reactive principle number two. A reactive application must be scalable. The system should be able to efficiently grow based on the demand placed on it. It should be able to replicate easily on or across multiple nodes. And so as we build, we may not know what the application topology will be when we start out. We might think that we're going to use, you know, two servers with one database or whatever, or you know, a couple AWS instances. But as we grow our application, that may change. And so as we're building our applications, we need to define our systems so that they're able to scale. And the reactive principle says that there's two main components for two main criteria for an application or service to scale. And that's one, that you write your systems such that they minimize contention on the resources within them, meaning that if one thread or process is blocking access to a service or another resource, then other threads, connections, et cetera, will all have to wait. So this reduces the cap availability because we require more resources, e.g. more machines, and if we're having a slow website, that will make the user really mad if they notice the slowdown. Horrible contention will have a direct monetary cost as you scramble to scale your resources and keep the end user happy. Minimizing the contention on resources will come as a natural emergence of adopting asynchronous message passing. And step two, you need to make sure that you maximize locality of reference. This is a very complicated topic, such so that I couldn't find a snappy image for it. But basically what it means is that within a service, if data is accessed frequently, that means it has high temporal locality, meaning that that's probably a good candidate for caching. If in a database, if we have a fewer amount of joins needed to pull all that data out, that means it has good spatial locality, meaning the items are close to, or the data is close together in the database. It's a very complicated topic, and this takes on a different, more sinister twist when we start talking about microservices, which I'll get into in a bit. Principle number three, your reactive application must be resilient. Now what that means is that you should be embracing failure, embrace that catastrophic failures will most assuredly occur at some point within your system. Have the mindset that at any given moment your code is gonna break. Think to yourself, how tightly coupled is my code? How dependent on other services, domain objects, third-party APIs, et cetera, is my application? How many of your systems out there are held together by metaphorical duct tape, right? A strong breeze, blow them all down. What happens if any one of those components go down? The worst thing that you can do is know that catastrophe is coming, or how it could come, and do nothing about it. A reactive application is resilient to failure. If one service node breaks down, the others should be able to take up the slack. If one feature goes down, the others should still operate. Your system should be able to suffer damage and still function to some degree. For example, in the e-com application from earlier, if the order placement system goes down while your team is scrambling to fix it, certainly, the user should see, could see, some message that says, hey, sorry, we can't take orders right now, but they can still browse, they can still change their information, they can still add items to the shopping cart. But better yet, you could still take those orders, put them on a message queue, and then just when the order placement comes back up, then you start processing them again. Independent things should fail independently, right? The mantra for building a resilient app should be independent things fail independently. And This also occurs naturally with async and microservices. If I'm broadcasting a message, I don't particularly care about who gets it or what they do with it. I'm just saying, hey, there's some information. Step number four, an application should be responsive. Your application, and I don't mean like responsive design responsive, I mean your application in general should respond to user interaction as quickly as possible. Each service should be handling events quickly. The more responsive your application is, the more pleasing experience it is to the end user. The less time they sit staring at the little loading screen, the happier they'll be. In fact, there's two interesting points here. Has anyone ever heard of the 1,000 millisecond time to glass challenge? No? Google did a study a couple years ago where they figured out that there's a threshold for user mental focus as they're looking at a page and the time it takes to load the web page. And they found that any time over 1 second, a user's mental context shifts and they stop focusing on what they're doing. And the longer that delay is, the less likely they are to remember what they were doing, the less likely they are to continue, and there becomes a point where they will not come back to your application if it's too slow. Any time under a second, there's no noticeable difference in their mental preparedness. So there's a rule out there called the 1,000 millisecond time to glass challenge, and it's a good strategy to try and get your pages to render under that 1 second time. Another interesting responsive point. A couple years ago, there's an engineer with Amazon named Greg Linden who revealed that the company ran an experiment where they intentionally slowed down site performance. And as anyone knows, Amazon is one of the pioneers of services, of service SOA. That's why we have Amazon Web Services, because that's an end result of their internal development. But so they intentionally slowed down the services, and they noted that there is a very real correlation between actual time and their ability to make money. And they found that for every 100 millisecond delay, affected their sales by 1%. So every one, so 500 millisecond delay, 5% drop in sales. That's huge. How long does it take your e-commerce site to load? 2 seconds? 3 seconds? Yeah. In other words, the four rules of reactive applications are, sorry, I watched Fight Club the other day. I know I'm feeling all anti-consumerist. He says from his Mac laptop. Four points, never block, share no state, independent things fail independently, and be fast. And that being said, there's no single correct reactive architecture. Right? Even though I've been talking about this, I showed some examples. There's no single right way to do this. Rather, reactive is just a mindset. Or a state of being. It's a goal that you need to orientate your thinking around when you're designing or architecting your individual service nodes and your distributed application. The TypeSafe company created a website called a site called the Reactive Manifesto, which you can go in and digitally sign with Twitter or whatever. And if you like all this, go check it out. It has a very long and detailed description about all of these features. But there's one interesting quote that's in there, and they say that an application must be reactive from top to bottom. Now, they're not specifically talking about microservices, but I think it applies here. So if we go back to our original e-commerce example, if we want to make this reactive, I think you can probably see where I'm going with this. We could first, of course, break this up and make it SOA, and we could do some synchronous HTTP. Wait a minute, I said never block. So what we should be doing is, again, routing stateless messages, immutable messages, asynchronously, rules number one and two, probably through a message broker. When we reach, and again, I think this is a very interesting point because a reactive system tends to emerge from reactive services. So if we build each of our services so that they're individually written around a reactive principle and we slap in a message queue, A reactive microservice system emerges out of that approach. And once you reach the point where messages are just asynchronously bouncing around your system, it seems crazy, but it's really fascinating. You can sit back and you go, ah, nice. I don't know. Sit back and whistle. That's me. I can't whistle. Anyone have any questions at this point? No? Yes. Yeah. So are you asking how do I broadcast messages, or how do I deal with incoming messages and then rebounce them?
You have a correlation issue, right?
Maybe. So maybe it'd help if I give a couple example messages you might see in a system like this. So if I'm going in and I'm browsing through the application and I'm logged in as a user, and I click on the screen and I see a product I like and I click add to shopping cart. The front end could simply just, instead of trying to do anything heavy, it just simply drops a message on my exchange that says something like user added item to cart, and then it's done. And then any particular item that cares about that particular event could listen to it and each receive a copy of it. Particularly in this case, the shopping cart system is very interested in that information, but maybe I have a logging service that's also interested in that information. If the user clicks, purchase, an event's going to go out in the system that said, user clicked order. The order system's really going to care about that information. And then it's going to say, now I need to know what's in that user shopping cart. So it could, emit an event that says something like request information for user shopping cart. And that the shopping cart might know that information. And then could either, send a programmatically generated queue, send that information back to that particular service, or re-emit that information as another event. And that seems like it generates a lot of traffic, and it can. Having Rabbit in the middle is very nice because it can handle quite a lot of traffic. Yes?
How does that model go with not holding state? Are you passing around information inside your event?
So the question was, how does that deal with not sharing state? Very good question. I'm going to talk about a little bit of that in a minute. But as a preview, you don't want to keep individual state, and so you can get a little bit chatty as you are asking for information. An alternative approach is to basically just send everything that might be needed for that particular request in the message. So, yeah. Anything else? All right. So a more interesting topic. Let's talk about some practical development. So some tips when working with this sort of approach. By nature, working with microservices, you're going to have an amazing amount of code reuse. An organization will tend to standardize the deployments, the technologies they use, the languages, et cetera, and the internals of a new service. And this is generally a good thing, I guess, but it can lead to a great amount of code reuse and boilerplate and things like that. And I was going to have I was trying to grab an image of some Legos or a brick or something, but the Wi-Fi was not working out well today, so apologize. So what we should be doing is extracting the common code into sets of shared testable libraries, and then we should be composing each of these services out of the shared libraries, so that working with each new service, you only have to reason about the particular custom code. Step number two, one thing we should be doing is appointing an architect or a design team to sort of lord over everyone that's building these services. So we need somebody in charge to keep everyone on task and following the reactive microservice approach. It's very easy to stray, and if you're working on a service, to start making it larger than it needs to be, or giving in to not using some asynchronous messages internally and things like that. This can also be an authoritative committee as well, if that's too much power in one person's hands. But keep in mind that everyone in that committee is going to have an opinion on how things should run. Also, empower your teams. Make them responsible for their product. I missed the slide, the image there too. I apologize. Amazon has a philosophy where every team in charge of a service is responsible for it for its entire life within your application. So from start to finish, from deployment, every feature that gets made, even while the system is in the wild, that team is responsible for it. And that's pretty good motivation, I think, to write good code, because the last thing you want to do as a developer is a bug you fix, you're responsible for fixing at 3 a.m, right? Also, embrace eventual consistency. I mean, that's a bit of a mind shift, right? So if I have a distributed application, I do lose some transactionality, and so it becomes difficult if I do need to roll back some information. So that is, you know, this concept's difficult for people to acknowledge, but you know, sometimes it's okay to not have full transactions, right? So again, Amazon is another example. If I place an order with their system, they come back and they say, hey, you know, thanks for placing the order. But if they mess up somewhere along the line, they'll send you an apologetic email that says, hey, sorry about that, we tried to process your order, it didn't actually work out. We're sorry, here's something to make you feel better. And this goes back to, I think, to your question. Be very, very worried about reference locality. Be really worried about it. In an ideal environment, each system would be completely separate, right? However, there is always going to be some conceptual overlap. For example, let's say we have a system where we have our web front end, we have Rabbit Queue in between, we have a user service and an order history service. The concept of a user is not going to be limited just to that user service as much as we'd like it to. Our order history service might be tied to a user's unique ID. So these red lines indicate anchors between between the domain object. But here, the user's UID is a shared natural key which acts as both the service's anchor to understanding the concept of a user. Maybe it's just one point. In our main user service, understands much more information about the user, and our order history service understands all their orders, but they have that shared anchor point. That's a good question. So I argue it shouldn't be. So these are two individual services, and each have their own frameworks, each have their own data store, communicating with each other solely by messages through Rabbit, which can seem a little crazy at first, right? I mean, why have the concept of user? Why would I share them across the different databases? It's a good point. But again, by each service, that particular database might be on, let's say, the user service, we might decide that Mongo is best, and then order history service may be something that's, you know, higher rate might be nicer for managing the order history. But I still need to keep some sort of reference between the two databases about that user. Now, if I add another service, email, the service also conceptualizes the user, but with a different subset of information, namely the email address. Oops. Basically, that user table down there, which you can see in the bottom, there's another anchor between the user's email address and a user table within the communication service that has an email. And so this is where it starts to get tricky, and this is something you should be watching out for and probably not do. Because the email service uses the email address, you know, quite a bit, but should it be the authority on the user's email, or should the user service maintain that information? The email service uses by far more often than the user service might. It has higher temporal locality, but it probably should be managed by the user service, thus keeping down reference locality, or spatial locality. So one compromise is to, which you unfortunately probably should not be doing this, is to try and synchronize the email address. So if a user service changes, if the user goes in and changes their email address, the user service could emit an event on the RabbitMQ that basically says, you know, user details changed. Order history might care about that, but probably don't. There might be another service that cares about. Email service would definitely care about it because they want to update their email address. That's workable, but it can lead to problems where if they get out of sync at all, then you have to try and find a way to resynchronize that information back. Or, like you were suggesting, anytime an email gets sent out, I could just blast along the user's email address along with the message that needs to go out, and the communication service is basically just going, okay, great, and just firing emails out. That's also fine. Some practical development with Groovy. So it's we're working in the. Oh, sorry, question. Oh, yeah. Sorry about that. Yeah, I should probably elaborate. Yeah. So it's part of working on the. That's probably a key piece of information that I can go on. She asked, how was the deployment for each of these? Let me go back to this example real quick. sorry? Sure. I'm not sure I understand. Are you asking how I reuse shared code between the individual services? Okay. So if I think I understand the question, how do we deal with deployment and how do we deal with shared code? One of the first things you should be doing is writing any code that is shared and common between all of your services in shared libraries and making sure that each service is written using those components. Therefore, the only code that you're reasoning about when you're writing a service is anything that's unique to just that service. So the very first thing you should be doing is writing a library that handles and abstracts away from the individual teams all of the communication strategies. On that service. And I should also reiterate that each service is deployed individually, which can seem kind of crazy, because if I'm now having a bunch of services, it seems like it'd be more difficult because I'm having to deploy different things, but it makes it very easy to do things like continuous delivery, because if I can quickly rip, you know, if I'm responsible for that one deployment, I know how it works, I know how to maintain it, I can deploy new things, I can add new services again that are all hooked up to that same queue. And they each could have their own data store. They might not. They might have a shared database. They probably shouldn't. So I'm not being terribly specific because it's going to fit whatever best works within your particular group. Let me get through the rest of this and then we'll stop for more questions. So practical development with Groovy. So in the Grails in the JVM world, we have a great amount of very interesting tools that we can work with. It's an exciting time to be building these scalable distributed applications. The first one is Akka. Boo. Akka's great. It uses a concept of something of an architecture pattern called the actor pattern. I'm not smart enough to understand how that works, but conceptually, you basically build out an actor which knows how to handle a particular message, and then you scale out those actors as far as they will fit within the resources of your system. An actor has a single mailbox. And it receives messages, and then it reasons about those messages and does something, and then it may or may not broadcast out a response. Now, the interesting thing about this is that these actors have their own individual configuration, their own individual deployment, and you access the actors by accessing them through a proxy, which allows you which allows these actors to be distributed abstractly or independently of however you're reasoning about it. So you don't have to worry about what's being handled. It's the underlying code will figure out how to best work the actors within your resources. You can even distribute them across multiple machines, which is, you know, pretty interesting. It's used by a lot of really big companies to do some pretty dramatic things in terms of computation power. What's that? It does use Scala, or it was built around Scala, but it works fully well with Java, works with Groovy. But you know, so if you go to the website, they have here's how you do it in Scala, and here's how you do it in Java. Second, a language called or a library called Reactor, which I really like, and I think it's the most straightforward of all of these tools. So that example I showed you earlier was built using Reactor, but I had a bit of an abstraction on it just sort of to make it a little bit easier to read. Reactor is my favorite again because I think it's the most straightforward. So Reactor. Basically gives you a Reactor instance is essentially a central dispatcher within your service. And you can use different dispatcher types, like your standard event loop. That's the same model that Node.js uses. You can also use something called an LMAX disruptor ring buffer, which I don't understand, but it's pretty wild. And there's a bunch of other ones that are in there. That's what I was gonna get at. And so when you wanna broadcast a message, I have to set up my Reactor by first specifying my current environment, and you have one Reactor per environment. So again, it acts as a central dispatcher within your system. I then have to specify which dispatcher type I'm using. Here I'm using the event loop, because it's, again, pretty straightforward. And then I'm assigning it to a variable within this service. And then when I want to notify that an event happened, I can do a couple things. I can broadcast it over a particular key that I then match on, which was what I was showing you earlier. I can use a regular expression. I can use a URL template, which is pretty interesting. And then when I broadcast a message, I have to wrap it in an event, which goes out, and then each of the recipients, when they get it, they'll get that event, and then they can access the object that was in it by just accessing the data keyword. And when working with it in Groovy, it's very easy to just use a closure. I should probably go back to the other example to make it a little bit more readable. Let me skip back real quick. Hold on 1 second. So if we jump back here, so knowing what I just showed you, so here when I'm starting out here and I'm notifying that an order was created, that I then broadcast the order, and I'm abstracting away that the fact that the order gets wrapped in an event before it goes out. And then when any time the order service is listening on the central dispatcher, in this case event service is the reactor, anytime it's notified about, or it sees an order created event happen, I give it a little closure, which basically has an event with the order in it, and I basically take that event, and then I pass that event.data, which is an order, into my long-running job number one. And then an inventory service, when I just use the same closure, and I also grab an event that contains an order, and then I mark, I check to see if there's inventory. I then, based on the Boolean results, I then broadcast on a different event type with that string that's auto-created or it's auto-filled with the true or false. And so then there's two possible events that can come out of there. Which an interesting point is that it doesn't like a G string there, it'll blow up, so I have to say two string. And then in my, again, back in my money service, if I see order inventory true, then I know to execute asynchronously, billing the user, and then if I see true or false, then I know to send different emails. And like I was saying earlier, this is very, very easy and fun to unit test, because I just have to, test each of these particular handlers with a particular event. I don't have to mock out or stub in each of the individual services and mock them as collaborators within my spot test, which can drive you mad if you've ever had a giant, highly coupled thing. It's not, no fun. Let's see, so going past that, what else do we have? Netflix, the folks at Netflix have given us Reactive X, which is a collection of libraries, all using reactive streams. Has anyone here used RX Java or anything like that? Yeah, I've tried it once. I'm not smart enough to quite understand exactly what's happening. So from my limited perspective, basically what it allows you to do is to asynchronously operate on a stream of data. So I can do simple things like generate what's called an observable from a list of orders, and then asynchronously log info on them. And I execute that call by using that subscribe function. I could have a more complicated example which takes a bunch of orders that are all filled by a date greater than some particular time, and then I could do a map reduce on them to calculate the total number of items that I processed, and then I could, at the very end of it, send out an email, or if there's an error, I can log the error, things like that. I can also do a similar publish-subscribe approach by generating what's called a publish subject, and then I can keep those running, and then anytime I want to broadcast an event, I can call this onNext function and fire an order onto the stream, and then anyone who's currently a subscriber will get that stream or get that data asynchronously because they're all subscribed to that particular stream. There's a whole lot more to it than that, and it's pretty wild. Luckily, the documentation has really nice, colorful charts that show you how things happen. Now, with Grails specifically, we have a bunch of built-in asynchronous processing methods. Probably the most important is the promises that came around in, pretty sure it was Grails 2.4, 2.3? Yeah. But what promises allow us to do is to asynchronously run long-running tasks without any additional libraries or anything like that. It's built on, I think, gpars, which is an interesting parallel library. Here, I can in this first example, I'm executing three tasks. For some reason, promise uses the keyword task to execute, which is a little weird conflict. And then I'm waiting for each one of those things to be done asynchronously, taking the result in the order they came in. I can also execute a long-running task and then have asynchronous callbacks. So that wait all up in there in the fourth line, that's actually blocking until all three complete. In the example down there, it just goes on and it waits for it to asynchronously finish, and then it will execute something on complete or on error. I can execute chains of promises. So when one completes, I can then do another one, another one, another one. There's also, and I think this is probably, this will give you the biggest bang for your buck if you're doing this right away, but in my controller actions, I can wrap the response in a task, and then that will asynchronously take those orders and render them out. This is something you can do very quickly, and it will help a lot, as long as you're using servlet 3.0 in your build config. Now, so far, this has all been some pretty interesting stuff, but it's not all sunshine and roses out there. There are some caveats to working with microservices, as I'm sure you all can guess. It's not going to be the right fit for everyone. So a WordPress blog that your parents are building, or a local restaurant site, or any general informational page is probably not a good candidate for this approach. Now, if you're just a little startup, you might be saying, I'm not yet a huge internet giant. You keep talking about Amazon. I'm not Amazon. Why do I need to do this? Right, this seems really hard. And it's true. It's not easy. But how much more difficult would it be when you eventually realize that this approach will help you? The initial investment for doing this is very large. You need to come up with communication strategies right away. There's a lot of groundwork you have to do to get these services up and running, figure out an effective communication strategy so you're not killing yourselves. And it's very, very difficult. But this investment in time and money will have huge payoffs in the end. It may look crazy, especially if you try to propose this to like your boss or something, and he's like, that's wild. But it's going to have, in the initial investment, will pay off in the end. Another thing to worry about is make sure that everyone's on board when you start this. If someone on your team doesn't agree or doesn't understand how these microservices should work, it's possible that they may create a faulty service, like that doesn't work with the asynchronous fashion, is not properly broadcasting, et cetera, et cetera. And so that's why we have the architect or the committee above them to make sure that, to audit these services to make sure that everything's working properly. It can lead to team animosity. So going back to Conway's law, when people are building these services, it can begin to lead to an us versus them mentality, right? If I'm working on the email service and the user authentication is broken, you don't want your teams to just sit there and be like, I can't do anything today because I can't get any user information. Encourage teams to cooperate with each other. If something's broken, have them go, have other teams go in and help out. You can cycle team members between services so that people can get a perspective on what's going on in the other groups. So this goes back to Conway's law again. Make sure that your teams are working together when designing their services. Otherwise, you'll find that certain services are tailor-made to communicate more efficiently and affect indirectly with others. Any questions so far?
I just want to go back to tasking and
Grails. Sure. So this is built on Servlet 3, which I'm not exactly sure how it works, but your browser makes a request, and the underlying container tracks that's happening. That tracks the connection is still there, but it doesn't keep it open, and it allows another user to come in and make another request. But you need to you need to tell Grails that you use Servlet 3. I think this is default now, but it used to be 2.5, which this would do nothing if you tried that. Yes. How does it keep track of the order?
Yeah.
You mean the order in which I receive messages?
Yeah. Like, I think you
gave an example of adding to the message. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I probably won't jump back. But so your question is, how do I maintain the order in which I receive events?
Yeah.
That's a good question. It's most of the time, it shouldn't matter. Like if I'm adding two items to a cart, this is important. If I'm adding two items, that doesn't really matter. But if I'm adding an item and then deleting it, that matters. So, has anyone heard of a concept called event sourcing? What's that? Yeah, exactly. There's this is a common problem in that situation, but basically which you can do if it is a important step like that, where if I'm trying to delete something that hasn't yet, if I receive the delete message before I receive the add message, if you know that the certain things like that are important, you can add flags to the message that basically say, you know, oh, this is step number X in this approach. Or if my service notes that I have a created timestamp on the message if I receive the deleted first and then I receive the added, I know the added happened or was started later, so I know that I should ignore it because I received a message that happened after. It depends on the particular situation. But that is another very complicated thing that the question was: Do I want to go back and search the queue? That's a good point. No, and in fact, you probably can't, and you shouldn't. So that's you should just act upon the messages that you receive. And for the most part, when I push message on the queue, I can expect that if I'm using a reliable broker, I can expect that it's not going to come to me out of order. The messages that go in are processed and are emitted in the order that they occur. But I may receive two different types out of order, but you shouldn't ever need to scan it, and that gets into some a complicated discussion. And there's some theory. I'd be happy to talk more about it later, but yes, it's very, very tricky, and this stuff is not easy. Where was I? So in order to close this out, let's do a couple case studies. So in the end, though, I know it's complicated and it's very tricky, but in the end, it's worth it. So first up, our good friends at Netflix. They make heavy use of AWS, Amazon Web Services. They replicate bundles of services as demand dictates. And Netflix is huge on principle number three, resiliency. Specifically, they use a custom tool called the Chaos Monkey, which they run every day between 9 and 5, aka work hours, or when people are not at home wanting to watch movies. Netflix runs this on their services. And what this thing does is it goes around and it randomly destroys machines and brings them down to see how the other services will run. And I have it on good authority that they refer to this internally as shooting a service in the head. Furthermore, the Chaos Monkey is not the only one they have. They have a whole simian army that they use. There's a whole gang of these monkeys that go around and they do things like simulating high latency or simulating service degradation. It can be a helpful one, like going around and cleaning up any unused resources or killing anything that's not behaving well or fails a health check. Incidentally, they're also hiring apparently a chaos engineer, somebody whose job is to specifically worry about situations like this. So if, you know, coming up with crazy problems for services sounds fun, you should totally apply. So these services need to go in and they need to prove their strength in order to stand up to this army. This allows Netflix to find weaknesses in their bugs, weaknesses and bugs within their services. Again, like I said, part of the outcome of all of these, you know, reactive asynchronous stuff is they've released, in addition to Chaos Monkey, they've also released the ReactiveX approach. Incidentally, Netflix really loves Groovy. One interesting tidbit to think about, if anyone tells you that, you know, Groovy is not a great, you know, programming language or it's not useful, keep in mind that of all, you know, well, however much crazy traffic Netflix gets, a lot of that is running through Groovy code. Another related example, Twitter. So Twitter, at one point, was the largest, most monolithic Rails deployment in the world. Engineers, anytime they needed to make a change, would have to pull in big global experts to get anything done. And they'd have to bring these experts in to go on these big whale hunting operations or archaeological digs in order to add a new feature or find a bug. And that worked for a while. But the turning point came during the 2010 World Cup. So on that day, people were tweeting about their, you know, their favorite games and things like that. A flurry of tweets brought Twitter down to its knees. The service was unavailable. Engineers worked through the night to fix it. I thought about putting a vuvuzela sound in here, but I don't know if anyone remembers that, but decided not to. No. So they realized that they needed to do something because this was not working for them. And so they have this amazing blog, the Twitter engineering blog. If you haven't read it, you should check it out. It's a huge love letter to the microservice approach. So what they did, they were no strangers to the JVM, so they had a search application that was written using Java. So they shattered their monolithic application to a bunch of individual applications, and the size of the circles represent the number of deployments, each one of the particular service was using on this particular moment that this shot was taken. They built an internal messaging queue called Finagle, which helps to process these messages. Each one of the new applications had their own small, determined, dedicated team. And they switched from the Ruby virtual machine to using the JVM, specifically to using Netty and NIO, instead of procedural thread pooling based applications. And so when they were running their monolithic application, they had 200 to 300 requests per second per machine. When they switched to Reactive, they were able to squeeze out 10 to 20,000 requests per second per machine. And so during the 2010 World Cup, when everything crashed, they hit a record of 3,200 tweets per second. Now they average 5,700 tweets a second, and they've dynamically scaled it up to 143,199. And I specifically say that because that's just the limit. They could theoretically go higher than that. That's just the most they've ever gotten. And they've done all of this with 5 to 12 times fewer services than they did with Rails. Yeah, that's pretty good, right? Incidentally, JVM advocates and Rails detractors love to talk about how Twitter moved away from Rails to Java, but again, the architecture choice was more important. They could have gotten some of the benefits if they tried Rails. So let me talk quickly about how we're using it. So I should talk briefly about the company I work for. I wouldn't normally do this, but just to understand why this is important. So the company I work for is trying to, we're called Third Channel. The problem we're trying to solve is when a company that makes a product, let's say Ray-Ban sunglasses, when a company makes a product, they produce a whole bunch of units and they give it to a retailer, like Target or Dick's or whatever. But once they hand it off, what happens to that product. They don't know where it's being sold. They don't know how it's being sold. They don't know what the sales data is. They don't know anything. And if they did know that information, they could do things like target advertising, send their field reps out to make sure the inventory is displayed, educate the staff on marketing, that sort of thing. So we capture real-time observational data on products. It's marketing speak, so I'm not very good at this. We optimize the in-store experience and we help to increase sell-in, sell-through. But basically what this means is that we are doing in-store product awareness. And we're going out and we're using, right now we're running for about 6 months, and we're using college students, which we refer to as agents. They get paid pretty well, about $20 an hour, and they get college credit, and they get experience, they get to work for the brand as a rep, and it all works out really well for them. And so they go in and they gather observational data about how the product's being displayed, where it is, if anything's damaged, if there's any inventory on the floor at all. They also educate staff, they help sell to customers and things like that. We're also combining actual sales data from point of sale systems that we can get. And we're using that information to combine it, that combination of observational and empirical sales data. We're using that to help generate some product intelligence and analysis about what makes a good store and help improve sales. So there's two areas I think we deal in, and just having the agents in the stores helping to educate. Because the retailers, their perspective is that they just have floor space and they put stuff out there and they sell it and whatever. The stores that we've had agents go in have seen an increase in sales for those products, anywhere between 30 to 50% on just those products alone. And that's just one side of what we're doing. And so we also have, for the individual brands we have, and this is what the site looked on, the phone about 2 months ago, live real-time feeds of what's going on in the stores, any alerts that comes up, that sort of thing. So as part of our business, we need a good deal of services in order to run this thing. We have, as you might imagine, the front end, the lovely responsive piece that runs on the phone, plus a marketing site and some internally facing applications. We have our service that gathers all this observational data and makes it queryable for the rest of our services. We have, together all that data, again, we use what we call internally as the agents. Each customer might have several dozen to several hundred of these agents. So that's a lot of staff to manage. So we have several tools and a service or two that help our staff to manage all of these kids. Excuse me. specifically with helping with recruitment and management, you know, what stores they're assigned to, what they should go to be visiting. The observational server, and I believe the web interface, query this service to determine which store an agent is allowed to check into and who's assigned to what. And so the observational server doesn't maintain any state about the user. It just, all it knows is that which user is assigned to it. And so anytime we transition a user from, the observational server doesn't maintain who's assigned to it. That's the agent service. And so when the user goes to check in, it has to make sure the user is allowed to from a check to the agent server. And then it submits information that basically says a store visit was captured. And then this in particular, the binocular service is in particular listening for it and then saves that data. And there's some internal services which render it queryable for other front ends. We pay these agents. So we need a service to track all the work they've done. This also listens for the particular message or an event. So it can know that, agent X, had a check-in. So we have to record that they are going to get paid. And if we're working with, thousands of these agents, we do this every 2 weeks, having good services and good robustness here is very important. And this helps reduce, the better these tools are, this helps reduce the number of staff that we need to actually manage these kids. This so far is just mostly for the agents still. But we also have a notification service. So that little bullhorn down at the bottom is responsible for all important announcements that need to go out, emails, text messages. The kids love their text messages. Any internal notifications that you might see from the front end, like a user has commented on your check-in, and I don't know. We need services for pulling the empirical sales data from the services from the point of sale systems. So the little graph down there, there might be several of those which are going out and querying, getting third-party information back, and then also storing it. And then we'll have a bunch of services for aggregating data from both of those two, but periodically from both of those, for both the binocular and the little graph there, and pulling in data and make it queryable in different formats. We're making good use of event sourcing, so we have some event storage going on, but we might have a different representation that we might want to view it at for different queries. And we're still going. This is what we managed to work with in the past 7 months. And is each one of these services perfect? No. There's some problems, but we're iterating on them quickly. And I strongly feel that this helps us get what we need to get done faster than if we're just building one giant application. Certainly, we wouldn't be where we are in 7 months. And we don't have that large of a team to manage it all. But we have had some problems. So our lessons learned that we learned along the way. The absolute first thing that you need to do when you're trying these microservices is to agree on a messaging format. And this seems like a strange thing, but you'd be surprised at the petty fights that you might get in. Like I want the field to be called this, or I want to make sure that the bundle and the payload looks like this, or I want JSON instead of XML, and I want to use HADOS I want to use the HAL format. I want to use ATOM. It's very weird the arguments that can happen, but. But just make sure you agree on it, and then step number two, once you've agreed upon it, build a communication library that abstracts away all of these messages from the teams that are actually developing those services, so they don't have to worry about it, and then no more fights can happen. It was bad. Third, make sure that you're maintaining proper API documentation about each of these services. Things like what events they emit, and what additional custom fields come out of those events. What events that they respond to. So if I want to do, and this might be rare, but if I want to do an RPC call to fetch some information, and I want to use the asynchronously over a message queue, I should post what things I listen for, what data will accept, and what different responses that I might give you. And you can put this is in the GitHub README for the service. So any other team can go in and just quickly see that, I need to get this information out of you. Step number four, remember Conway's Law. Keep communication up between your service teams, especially when you're just starting out. Again, the petty fights. When these communication patterns are still in the early stages, it's very important that everyone in your entire team understand how it works, because you will probably see things that you didn't initially think about, and there'll probably be some iteration as you develop them until it becomes solidified after a while. And in fact, I'd recommend a meeting once or twice a week for your service any team leads on the service to get together, discuss things like, I'm planning on creating this new event. Is there anything in here that you might want? Hey, can we update the shopping cart service to also send along this particular data when it broadcasts an event so I can avoid stateless, or so I can avoid any state that I might need to go and query you about? Like, if I can get that data in the initial event rather than having to make a call to get it later, that keeps things less chatty and more efficient overall. And again, always think of data locality. So in our chart, I'm constantly paranoid about making sure that everything is in its proper place and separated and contained appropriately within its individual machine, and very, very worried about any state that's getting maintained across these services. And another thing, which is pretty interesting, this is, while I did say earlier that it's easier to find bugs in here, if something goes wrong with the event call, it can be hard to diagnose where along the chain it occurred if it's a long-running event. So it can be helpful to have another service that's listening for every single event and simply logs it. And that way you can keep track of the order and the time in which everything happened within the system, not just in the individual service. I mean, each service should keep a log itself, but it's nice to have one place to go and look. So we're getting down to the end here. So I'm going to finish up with, in summary, architecture choice is more important than any framework. I strongly feel that reactive microservices are the ideal web architecture. And if you want to work with reactive microservices, you need to adapt the mindset of being reactive. Constantly beware of CAP and data locality problems. And we should all strive to be a little bit like Netflix. With that, I say thank you. And does anyone have any questions? Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. So the question was, if I'm reactive in the front end and I'm posting data, how do I get the response back? Yeah, that's a really good point. If it depends on the particular instance. Like if I'm posting an order, probably don't need to wait. I can just say, hey, thanks for the order. If it's something that I do need to fetch data from, I can asynchronously have, when the request goes in, that particular user is waiting the response. And if I'm using the asynchronous controller, I can have a service that maybe goes out and fetches that, a call that goes out to service and fetches that information and then returns it back. So to you, to the end user, you're seeing your standard sort of maybe, wait spinner thing while the data is getting fetched. But while that's happening, that particular request is, the front end is shuttling that off to the side so it can handle more requests. And then when a response comes in, there's a callback that goes back and returns that response to the individual user. I'm not using a particular framework, but there are some out there, like I think Meteor.js is one. There's another one that's specifically built for Grails, and I'm blanking on the name at the moment. But there are some that can help you. Anyone else? WebSphere? Yeah. Oh, AppSphere. Atmosphere. Yes, that's exactly it. anyone else? Yes. Vertex. Yes, that's another good one. So the question was, have I heard about Vertex? Vertex is very useful. I think it was not abandoned or dropped a little while ago, I think. Wasn't there some sordid tale about the developer and he left and the company wouldn't let him keep developing? Something like that. But It's a very, very good little service. It uses the event loop pattern. It's like the JVM. It's like a JVM version of Node. I mean, Node, for all of its faults, is that it uses JavaScript. Right? It's very interesting that it brought event loop based programming on the back end to the masses. Right, it's becoming very popular, and so now people are getting more experience with this whole thing. And so we'll start seeing more services connected. But yeah, Vertex is very useful. And if you do need something that's just standalone, event loop, high throughput, Vertex is great. Ratpack also seems very interesting. I'd really be curious to try it and see if they've promised that it does something similar. Ratpack Web, there was an interesting talk a little while ago by Dan Woods, which I missed. anyone else? Yes?
I don't really understand your
application. Yeah, that's OK. Ah, yeah. So just for time's sake, I sort of skipped out a little bit on exactly how that all flows, because we're running out of time here, but I can certainly elaborate. But basically, the different users have different input or different views onto, or different views or different projections onto the data within the system. So when an agent is going in and checking in, the front end needs specific information in order to allow them to post data. Specifically, it needs to get information about what stores they're assigned to. But if I'm a product owner and I want to go in and see, you know, reports and stats and things like that, I have I obfuscated it a little bit, but there's some services that are gathering data from each of the backend services and then making reports available to those particular users. There's additional queries that they might be making from the front end, which goes out to different events that they might be broadcasting or requesting data back. Does that make sense at all?
So what technology do you use?
That's a very good question. What technologies are we using? Our front end is Rails for now. I'd like to move that away because it's the leftover initial prototype, and so we're basically sectioning off pieces of it. And as we build new technology, new services, we're not doing them in the original monolith. So as we slice pieces off, we're trying to pick the right tool for the job. So far, that's mostly been JVM. So we are using some Spring Boot. We're using a lot of Grails. So it's all groovy. Each of the services, we're making heavy use of Reactor. Spring Security. Let's see what else. I'm trying to learn more about RX Java and getting that in there. I have one of the guys I work with is screaming to get some Node in there somehow. So I probably have to give in and get some Node instead of Vertex. But yeah, so far it's been really great. And